Thank you all. You're back in your seats. Everyone's enthused. Thank you, Kay. It was just great hearing from you. Let's give Kay another round of applause. Happy to see the mayor bought a book. Cedar Rapids has made a tremendous amount of progress, and certainly Marion with Step Into Nature and Des Moines, we've got a lot to be proud of, and our small communities are doing a tremendous amount of work. Trees Forever and Iowa State Landscape Architecture, you know, has been doing our Iowa's Living Roadways program for 20 years, working with small communities on redesigning. And I'm really delighted to introduce the woman who directs that program for us and is also our director of programs, Carol Peter. Carol has also been leading an initiative here in Iowa, Bird Friendly Iowa. Trees Forever has been providing some basic support for that, and she's going to share that and introduce Joanna Eckles, our next keynote. Help me welcome Carol Peter.
Thank you, Shannon, and good morning, everyone. By way of introducing our next speaker, I do want to talk a little bit about our new initiative, and by way of explaining the initiative, I want to fit it in within what Trees Forever does across Iowa and Illinois. And when people ask me about Trees Forever and I talk about what I love about working at Trees Forever, I tell them it's an organization built around hope. It's built around optimism. And you know, when you think about planting a tree, you'll get some satisfaction out of that tree, but really you're planting it for the next generation. It's going to be enjoyed by as a mature tree by the next generation. And you know, we all want our children to inherit a healthy, sustainable world. And so we create these habitats around us. And also when we do that, trees root us in place. And we heard earlier about the older buildings help our young know where there are, well, where they are. Well, so do trees. And if you try this out, if you talk to anyone and ask them about a natural area that is special to them, I will bet that somewhere early in that description will be a tree or trees. That's that iconic connection to nature that many of us have. And it's a fun little thing. I do it often, actually. Ask people about their favorite natural place. And as I said, trees often will factor in there. And if you think about why that is, we as a species, it's been pretty much agreed upon now that we are a savanna species. Our ancestors, our prehistoric ancestors, lived in savanna-like settings, which is grassland mixed with trees. And we create that, the homesteaders in the 1800s. If you look at this picture, it's a little bit hard to see, but this family is sitting proudly next to this tree that they planted. And what's really difficult back here is there's a whole bunch of trees that they've planted back there. And we do that. We plant trees when we move places. And Willa Cather, I was an English major at one point, so I always have to weave in an author at some point. Willa Cather wrote in My Antonia, trees were so rare in that country and they had to make such a hard fight to grow that we used to feel anxious about them and visit them as if they were persons. And you can see that tree factors in as a person in this family portrait. And I flew out of Cedar Rapids a few weeks ago, and I was looking down at the landscape, and you can see that in our farmsteads. There's fields all across the landscape here in the Midwest, but we also create the savanna-like setting in our farmsteads. And this is a typical Iowa farmstead that you might see as you're traveling through the roads or flying over. And we do that in our neighborhoods. We're a prairie state, but if you look at our towns and our cities, we plant trees, and that's where we feel comfortable, that's where we thrive, and we even plant trees for our cars, because we want our cars to feel comfortable. So that leads up to what we're introducing today is an initiative, as Shannon referenced, Bird Friendly Iowa. We have the person who, here amongst us, we have the person who really brought this concept to Iowa, Rick Zarwell. Rick, could you wave for us? Rick and his wife Betty are here from Lansing, Iowa, and Rick is a preeminent birder and is well known across the Midwest, across the country, across the world even. They travel quite a bit birding. And Rick was very familiar with an effort in Wisconsin called Bird City, Wisconsin, and Rick came to Tree Forever and asked us if we would help fledge this program in Iowa. So we're still in the incubation stage, and I will stop with the bird puns. you might think, well, what's the significance of this? Well, 20% of all Iowans watch birds, whether it's bird feeders or going on birding trips. And if you're a birder, you might think only 20%, or if you're not into birds, you might think as many as 20%. But what this translates into in Iowa is nearly $1 billion. This is the latest statistics we have from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. Almost $1 billion was spent in Iowa on wildlife watching activities, the majority of which was birding. It was twice as much as hunting and fishing. That was as of 2011. That was within a year that was spent. So our interest as a conservation organization is that this is another way to connect with people. You know, trees are a good connector. Birds are a good connector, but we also share habitat in common, birds and humans. And in fact, Rick and I were just talking during the break. There's a book called Suburbia, and I hope I don't. Rick, feel free to correct me if I get this wrong. But one of the things that the researchers of that book found was that there's more diversity within suburbs, diversity of birds, and more birds than you might find in a natural area. Did I get it right? You're nodding, so I got it right. Thank you. So real quick, Joanna's gonna talk about what is happening in Minnesota for Bird City, Minnesota, but some of the objectives for Bird City or Bird Friendly Iowa is we wanna work with communities, organizations, and volunteers to create and enhance essential habitats that support birds and of course support humans. We want to educate people about the importance of birds and healthy ecosystems, and we want to provide recognition for those communities. We're going to start just at the community level for those who work for sustainable solutions for birds. And this is based on the premier effort in the country is Bird City, Wisconsin. They have a great website. Go visit their website. But it's also happening in Indiana, in Minnesota, and Pennsylvania. And again, I said that Joanna is here today to talk to us about what is happening up in Minnesota for Bird City, Minnesota. Joanna is with the Audubon, Minnesota, and she has watched, studied, and worked with birds all of her life. She received her bachelor's degree in natural resources and wildlife science at Cornell University and her master's degree in conservation biology at the University of Minnesota. She has worked extensively both with wild and captive birds in the field as well as at the Minnesota Zoo. In 2006, Joanna began working with Audubon, Minnesota to study bird window collisions and develop a program to address the problem, a significant source of bird mortality. Project Bird Safe is now a core part of Audubon, Minnesota's mission to conserve birds in urban areas, not just in the state, but across the country. And the project involves monitoring existing buildings, researching species affected locally, influencing the design of new buildings, and encouraging the retrofit of problem buildings. More recently, she has helped to begin to initiate the Bird City, Minnesota program, which is a municipal recognition program very similar to Bird Friendly Iowa. And she's here to tell us a little bit about that today. So please help me welcome Joanna Eckles.
Thank you very much. First, thank you for having this conversation to begin with. It's so inspiring to see so many people from government and from nonprofits working together to talk about these really interesting and vital discussions. Thanks for bringing birds into it and also bringing me into the conversation. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna talk about bird-friendly communities overall. Like, what does that mean? What does it mean to be a bird-friendly community, to create a bird-friendly community? How we're working with municipalities in Minnesota to encourage these bird-friendly actions. And then we're gonna dive specifically into that one detail, which is an area that I just happen to have a lot of expertise around, birds crashing into windows. And it's sometimes seems to be this slightly peripheral subject, but it is actually quite pertinent to communities like you who are planning your community. So Audubon basically is a national organization, one of the oldest conservation organizations in the country. We're organized around very locally at the chapter level with hundreds of chapters across the country. I work out of a state office in Minnesota. There's not a state office in every state, but I work out of the state office in Minnesota, and we work on statewide projects, but also quite often working quite nationally. I think this is actually advancing on its own. So we're gonna just pause and get that turned off, because that'll mess me up. I've made the mistake of leaving that running that way. So is it on automatic timings? Because I'm not touching it. And it's...
Yes, it is.
Okay, great. Yes, that's good. So I, as Carol mentioned in the introduction, birds have been a central and guiding force in my life since I was in elementary school. And I've basically dedicated my entire life to working with and on behalf of birds, and I feel really lucky to have been able to do that. I think you just have to open the projector back up.
Yep. All right,
so now I'll go. So, you know, I don't, I mean, most audiences need to ask why birds matter, but sometimes it is important to sort of step back and say, beyond the just incredible fact that birds exist in their infinite variety, birds do actually matter. Birds are seed dispersers and insect predators. They are pollinators, which is a big area of concern these days. Birds are the hunter and the hunted, or sometimes just goofy friends like that, staying in the same branch. They're key indicators of the quality and health of our environment, and they are fascinating to watch as part of a $41 billion industry across the country. And for the most part, birds are protected. With very few exceptions, birds are protected by state and federal laws, so it's important to consider them in our planning. Birds are also incredibly accessible. I actually changed this slide after seeing a flock of turkeys on our tour around town. There's probably no other living creature that you can find any time of year, any time of day, and any place. Birds are pretty much ubiquitous. We can find them in just about every landscape. If you love snakes, you got certain times of year in certain places you can go find snakes, or even mammals on a given day. But birds are all around us, and they're the perfect conduit for nature education, for engaging people in nature. So across Audubon, we work in these five strategic areas, and this one is mine, bird-friendly communities. And I've come to look at that as these three things: engaging people, increasing habitat anywhere and everywhere we possibly can, and reducing the threats that birds face throughout their life cycles. So I do that through two programs: Bird City Minnesota, which is a pilot program now, and this project Bird Safe, which is about bird window collisions. And what we've done really is we've now taken Bird Safe and sort of shuttled it underneath Bird City, with Bird City being our big focus, because it really addresses all of the different things you can do, not just reduce window collisions, but in addition to that. So Bird City basically is a bit, the big picture is making our communities healthy for birds, but also for people, and really stressing that when you make birds healthy, you make people healthy too. And I'm glad for the little introduction to Bird Friendly Iowa. We have very similar goals, and a lot of the things I'll talk about are directly applicable to what they're working on here. So I look at it in two ways. I look at it as both a recognition program at face value, but it's really more of an education program too, because once communities are in the program, then they have this sort of roadmap to work on things they may have never even thought were an issue, or to find a way to step into these issues that they want to get involved in but didn't really have a direction. So that's what we're trying to create our program. We're using a lot of information from Bird City, Wisconsin, and from other efforts around the country, and trying to create this education program foremost. So in planning, we had to really look at this question: what is it that makes a community bird friendly? And it comes back to those things: action in those three areas, habitat, threats, and people. And so we looked at all of our plans and everybody else's plans, and we looked at all the different problems and all the different solutions, and we came up with 18 best practices for creating bird-friendly communities. What I'll do is I'll walk kind of quickly through those categories, three categories, and through the best practices that we came up with. And our idea was to try to think of everything and make sure it fits somewhere in that framework. So in the category of increasing awareness, educating people, increasing awareness of birds in your community. And I will go a little bit into this one because I looked specifically at something called eBird. Does anybody ever heard of eBird? I know the Zarwells have. So good, I'm glad I pulled these up. So eBird is an international database where birders submit their sightings. And when I go to a new place, one of the first things I'll do is I'll look at eBird. And you can see where people are birding in your community. And you can see, interestingly, how it follows the river. But each one of those spots is a place where people have submitted checklists. And overall in Iowa, on eBird, 393 different species have been recorded. And if you look into the counties, you'll see that Linn County is the fifth highest county for both species and checklists submitted. And then you can further dial down and see where what people are seeing. So this gets to who are your birding resources in your community, and also the places that they're going. So I just pulled screenshots of those top places. But this starts to get you, as you start to work in any community on creating a bird-friendly community, these are your places and these are your people. And they're out there and they're counting, and they're often willing to help with all kinds of restoration issues. So number two, involving residents in conservation and stewardship projects. I'll just use the example of the city of St. Paul has a vast volunteer program where they actually bring in volunteers to help with all kinds of things, from seed collection to restoration projects. And they do that explicitly because involved citizens are citizens that are going to care about these projects going forward. Educating and engaging youth audiences. I think we all know that childhood isn't the same as it was when a lot of us were young, and kids aren't getting outdoors as much. And so a lot of us are working in many different ways to get youth and young people engaged and interested, not only for their help, but as stewards of the future. And a good way to get people involved is through citizen science, promoting citizen science, monitoring, and research. And I show this awesome little bird, which is called a chimney swift, because chimney swifts are often a great avenue for public engagement. Chimney swifts are an aerial insectivore, which means they spend most of their day flying around catching insects. But they can't perch like other birds do. They have these tiny, tiny little feet that are built for gripping on the sides of, these days, chimneys. And they roost in huge numbers in chimneys, often right in the middle of our downtowns. And nationwide, people come together to do something called chimney swift sits, where they sit and they count the thousands of birds sometimes that come down and into these roosts to sleep for the night. So just a little fun aside. But citizen science in general is a great way to get people involved. Ensuring access to nature is the last of the best practices under the engaging people category for us. And access is about a lot of things. It's about physical access, so that people, no matter where they live, have access, preferably within a 10-minute walk, to a natural area of some kind. But access is also about other things. It's about language, so making sure you have materials available in different languages at your site in signage or about your site in a brochure. And it's other things too, making sure there's a trail somewhere, you know, in some of your parks, preferably in all of your parks, that if somebody's in a wheelchair or using a walker, they can use those trails. And also things like programs for maybe blind or hard of hearing. You can do programs specifically to those audiences about birds and birding and nature. The second category is all about habitat, protecting, restoring, enhancing. So all the things we can do to make habitat better and more healthy as an ecosystem. I start with this one, practice conservation planning. You know, as if the ecosystem might just support all living things on Earth. You know, just saying. Creating and protecting habitat everywhere and anywhere we can. This happens to be my front yard, which has been crazy in this time of summer. But front yard gardens, backyard gardens, boulevard gardens, anywhere and everywhere we can. And when we're doing that, promoting the use of native and beneficial species, I conclude both native and beneficial, realizing that there are some plants that are exotic plants, so-called, but they actually have a lot of wildlife benefit. And at the same time, specifically setting out to control invasive and detrimental species in the same way. I use cattail. We have problems with hybrid cattail. I don't know if you do here too. Reed canary grass, buckthorn, everybody's got their own suite of species, unfortunately. Creating and protecting nesting opportunities, and this can be partly with forestry by creating policies around snags or dead trees, leaving them standing for critical nesting habitat for birds like red-headed woodpeckers, but also the things that you can do in a community around nest boxes or platforms for all different species, kestrels, osprey, bluebirds, wood ducks. A lot of different birds do nest in nest boxes, and communities can not only set up those nest boxes, but use those for a community engagement, volunteerism, all kinds of education and engagement. And then ensuring best practices in urban forests, which is near and dear to all of you, and that's about canopy and diversity and also snags. This is a tree we killed in our backyard that for about 10 years until it fell down this spring is the absolute magnet for birds in our yard. Everything lands there, including this red-shouldered hawk that would come every day to the same branch one winter. So snags are an important part of that diversity of forests. And water, ensuring clean water in natural waterways. And I mentioned we specifically put natural waterways into the definition of this best practice because of work we're doing in Minnesota and people are doing all over the country about trying to return to the natural flow of some of our rivers, which are so controlled in many places. But what a lot of people don't know is that the natural hydrology of rivers needs to be this up and down flow, not maintained at a natural high water level like we often do for navigation. So we're working in Minnesota to try to work with the Army Corps of Engineers. It may never happen, but we're working on it, to allow for those natural low water levels. And what that does is that exposes plants, seeds, that most normally would be covered by water. And a lot of those plants are food, critical food, for waterfowl like trumpeter swans. So ensuring clean water, which is obvious, but the natural waterway. So the third category, reducing threats to birds. Birds face a lot of different issues throughout their life cycle because they cover so much ground in their life. A lot of birds migrate. So they're spending part of their year in South America where they got those problems. Then they're flying part of the year halfway across the country where they face all kinds of problems on migration. Then they got to get to wintering habitat or summer breeding habitat where there's all kinds of potential problems. And it's just like a gauntlet. So got to reduce threats anywhere we can. Reducing collisions with windows is one of those I'm going to talk more in depth about, so I don't need to say anything more about that now. Also, I have this catch-all about reducing other man-made threats, and that includes all the other things birds crash into besides windows, towers, turbines, power lines, but also other different issues that we create around garbage and entanglement and things like that. Reducing light pollution is another thing that's tied in with the collisions, but it's also just in general something we all needed to pay a little more attention to. Light pollution has gotten absolutely out of hand across the country, and I don't even think we're thinking about it. I've heard places where they'll have a blackout, and people will call their city officials and say, "Oh my God, what is that?" It's the stars. Seriously, they've never seen the stars, or they've never seen the Milky Way. That's a true story. Number 16 on reducing threats is mostly about cats, because cats have an enormous, they're an enormous problem for not only birds, but also mammals, and it's important for us to care about native mammals and mammals in the ecosystem. But also, in some cases, free-roaming dogs, especially during the breeding season, can be challenging for ground-nesting birds. Another threat is chemicals in the environment, toxins like pesticides, but also things, a lot of us are working on reducing lead, getting the word out to hunters and anglers about getting lead out of ammunition and fishing tackle. That has a real major implications for birds. Lead toxicity for birds is a serious problem for many species like bald eagles. And then the last best practice is all about climate, reducing climate impacts. Climate change is one of the biggest challenges facing wildlife of all kinds, even birds. And then the other thing we've put into our Bird City program is one requirement that we require of all communities, and that is passing a resolution recognizing International Migratory Bird Day, which can be a day of your choice to just celebrate migratory birds. And we ask them to do that with some kind of a celebration that's appropriate to the community. It may be a 5-day long festival, if that's what's appropriate for your community, or it might be eagle watching for 2 hours on a Saturday if you have a place for that. Could be the chimney swift sit, something like that. So we've made that very flexible. So then how that looks, and you don't have to read the fine detail because we just went through it, it ends up looking like this in our program. One required action of every community. We ask for 2 actions in the engagement category, 3 actions in the habitat category, and 2 actions in the threat reduction category. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to talk a little more in depth to help you see like how a community can tackle this specific problem. And you can see in the context, window collisions and light pollution are just some of the things we can do. But as I happen to have expertise there, I'm going to talk about that. So bird window collisions are a problem that are really just beginning to get the attention they deserve, partly because of a massive building that went in this year, just north of you in Minneapolis. I've been working on bird window collisions for 10 years, literally. And I used to always have to explain what I work on and why, but now all I have to do is say bird window collisions because the stadium in Minneapolis made a lot of press nationwide. But by the numbers, birds crashing into windows is the largest form of collision mortality. So in terms of the things they crash into, windows are the biggest thing. We hear a lot about turbines. We need to work on turbines and high tension wires and all these different sources, but because there are so many buildings across the landscape, from each of our homes to our biggest corporate buildings, there's just so much possibility for problems. And what we know a lot of things about this problem. We generally know what birds they are not. They tend not to be these birds that are used to living around people. What they are native migratory protected birds, all the birds that bird watchers are anxiously awaiting the return of every year.
why collisions happen. I'm just going to walk through this quickly so that we're all on the same page. Basically, there's two problems. There's nighttime causes and there's daytime causes. And at night, it's lighting. And there's two issues with lighting. Sometimes we have this beacon effect, bright lights shining up into the sky. This is an amazing photo of the 9/11 Memorial in New York City. This stands every year on the site of the former World Trade Towers. They shine these lights up into the sky, and it happens to be right at the height of migration on the eastern seaboard. And all the little specks you see in the lights are birds, because lighting is such a powerful attractant for wildlife. So the birds get in there, and they fly around within those cones of light as if it's a barrier. Luckily now, New York City Audubon has an effort that watches the lights. When a certain number of birds get in there, or they're flying and they're getting kind of low, they work with the organizers and they shut those lights off, the birds disperse, and they turn back on. And sometimes they do that 8 or 10 times a night if the migration is very heavy. Shows the power of lighting. The other issue with light is more of a sky glow effect. The reason that lighting affects birds is because a lot of the passerines, the songbirds, migrate at night. They're daytime, you know, in their everyday life, they're active in the day, but when it comes to migration, they travel at night. So this sky glow that sometimes happens around cities when the cloud ceiling's low and the light is shining up against the water in the air can create this same type of a situation as you get with the beacon or bright light. And then the other side of the coin is during the day. You have two issues there, too. You have reflection. So a bird looking at this thinks that that's something valid to fly to, a tree or the sky. But we see it differently when we see the context of the building there. So reflection is a huge problem. There's no reason for a bird to think that it can't fly there. And if you start to look at your own buildings from a sort of a bird's eye view, you'll start to see, wow, I get why this is happening here. And then the other issue in the daytime is transparency. So this see-through effect where you think you can fly through that to the habitat on the other side. And reflection and transparency can sometimes be combined. We have a lot of skyways in Minneapolis and St. Paul, and I see this a lot there. So what can be done, which is what we're all here for? And I can tell you quickly, these four parts of our program include research and monitoring, which helps us learn, and lights out and bird-friendly design, which helps us promote solutions. So this is just a quick example of one of the brighter buildings in Minneapolis going down at lights out. We run a lights out program working with building owners and managers to get some of these brightest buildings turned down. We also work on this whole issue of bird-friendly design. This is a book we put together, about 6 years ago now. It's subsequently been updated online, but it's working with architects, designers, and engineers to help them understand the issue. And we talk with architects about ways they can solve it. And then we promote solutions. The amazing thing is there are buildings all over the place that are actually built unintentionally bird-friendly. And that's using existing technology that helps birds see that there is an object there, but it wasn't designed for that purpose. So what is bird-friendly design? Bird-friendly, I kind of like this quote because it sort of gets at the essence of what we're trying to get at. There's nothing in which the birds differ more than man than in the way in which they can build and yet leave the landscape as it was before. And that's really not really statement about what we are doing, but more a statement, a visionary statement about how we can plan our communities with all of the ecosystem in mind. And so basically what we need to do is we need to do two things. We need to reduce hazards from glass, and we need to reduce light pollution. And in a sort of thoughtful framework, this is how I think about it. I'm going to use homes and I'm going to use towns as kind of an example. But at your home, you've got lighting and you've got glass. You've got existing lighting and glass that sometimes you need to fix because maybe it's light polluting or it's causing birds to crash. And then you have the opportunity sometimes to design new. Maybe you're putting on an addition or you're building new. And so you have opportunities to work on glass and lighting both in a retrofit and in designing new. The same thing goes for your town or campus or whatever. You've got existing problems, you've got new things coming online. And so, sort of how I look at it is the first thing you have to do is assess where you are with the buildings in your that you're in charge of, whether it's your home or your town. Plan what you're going to do to assess, to address the issues, and then implement the plan. Pretty simple, but I really see those as three different issues. And sometimes bird safety comes up because a new building's coming into your community and people bring your attention to this problem. Maybe you're working on LED conversion. We're seeing that as something that's coming up for a lot of people. Or you have an interest on a campus, like a corporate campus or something, in addressing bird safety. These are all the different avenues where it starts to come up. What I'm going to do now, because we don't have a ton of time, is I'm going to run through examples that show you solutions both for homes and for more commercial buildings. So these will be kind of quick. But in terms of assessment, how you assess what your problems are, you find out, you ask yourself or you ask people who work around your buildings, where have we heard or seen problems? And then you look around yourself and you see, where do we have reflection? Where do we have transparency? So where do we have potential problems for bird collisions? At home, one of the best things you can do, whether you're, if you're building new or renovating, is exterior screens. This is an example of exterior screens used on a porch where people often have problems because you often get those see-through effects. External shades, and I especially encourage these for places like a cabin that's hardly ever used but is sitting there as a danger, often with big windows in a big, beautiful, wild area. Interior blinds, a lot of people don't recommend interior blinds. I still say that sometimes blinds like this can help birds distinguish that there's a solid there. The only warning is that sometimes reflection on the outside surface can overwhelm any pattern that you might see behind. Also, I show the cat indoors there. You see that? Okay, you'll see a couple of those. I actually get photos from people where this family actually created screens where it's very difficult. They had to make these custom screens because they had so many problems when they moved into this house. And there are companies that make a screen that goes on the exterior of a door like this, for example, that you can't really put a screen on. So that's an example of a physical barrier. You can also hang things in front of your windows at home. This sort of gets to the spacing that tends to be recommended. These cords, these are like strings hanging at about 4 inches apart. And that's the dimensions that we found that most birds will say, whoa, and they'll turn away. Small birds can still have a problem with this, like hummingbirds, but you'll make a big difference with something like that. I get pictures from people all the time. This is somebody who literally hung branches. And I show these because you're not going to do these at your city hall, but at your home, you can do anything that you're willing to live with. And then adding a surface treatment is one of the most common ways that people handle this problem and is the way that you tend to do it at corporate or municipal buildings. To lights, quickly, basically I encourage people to put your yard light on a motion detector and use some kind of a cutoff. If you're seeing glare like this, then you have a light polluting fixture and you need to find a way to point that light downward. This is what we did with our front porch. We went through a lot of derivations until we finally just found a fixture that was a fold-down shield fixture. So we first started by painting the glass, and that worked, but only for a while. Anyway, down shield, put the light where you need it, not glaring into your neighbor's eyes, not pointing up into the sky. And then I'm going to talk through, I won't go through this again, but I want to show you how we've sort of laid this out for people to address bird window collisions in our Bird City examples, so examples of actions. The first thing you can do as a community is get information out. So we created a brochure about bird-friendly homes. So something as simple as telling people on your website about bird issues and providing them with information about how to handle it at home. Then assess your own city buildings for known problems. Talk to the people who work around your buildings and find out if there are places that this is a problem. Then plan a fix for your existing buildings that are under your control in your city. And then implement that plan. You know, maybe you do one thing at your worst spot this year, and you plan next year you're going to do that second thing, and on down the line. And then find a way to require bird-friendly bird deterrence to be planned in to not only the buildings that you create for your city, but also the buildings that come to you for approval in your city. And so that's sort of the systematic way. You got to start somewhere. So you start by information, and then you start by what you have control over, and then you start by what people are trying to build in your area. So that's how I've worked with cities in the past for creating ordinances and regulation around bird safety. Similar can be done for light pollution. Put your own buildings on lights out parameters, especially during migration. Assess your municipal lighting. Find out where you have that old-fashioned globe lighting that's shining light in all directions. Make a plan for starting to fix some of these existing problems and implement requirements for your own lighting and for lighting on projects that come to you, so that we don't have whole developments going in with those lights like I have my front porch lights, which is every light in my neighborhood. There are existing regulations at the national and then down into the local levels that can be models for ordinances in your community. And then I'm going to do the same thing and run through examples that would be more of a corporate example, both from the design end, when you're designing a new building, and the retrofit end, when you've designed one and it's proving to be a problem. This is a commonly available product called fritted glass. Fritted glass was not made for birds to see windows. It was made for energy efficiency. So it's patterns that are incorporated into glass. It's not always lines. It can be lines, dots, squares. All kinds of patterns can be made in the glass. You can see that this pattern looks just like those hanging cords, and that's because this pattern was designed for bird deterrence. It's one line that a window manufacturer in Minnesota is now carrying for bird deterrence, and this is at a nature center in Fridley, Minnesota. This is an example on a college campus where a custom frit at the bottom was used along with louvers at the top. Again, both of those things were originally for energy efficiency, for keeping the light and heat from penetrating that building. But they have this secondary benefit that they planned specifically in, especially on the bottom, for birds once that architect learned about this problem. This is a whole area of possible innovation. Dynamic glass is all these amazing innovations where colors and patterns are incorporated into the glass. It can be on a program where the lighting changes, the colors changes. We don't know for sure, but it's an area that has potential great innovation. This is an ultraviolet glass. This is a picture from yesterday out at your nature center. This is a glass that's relatively new on the market, taking advantage of the fact that birds see in a slightly different lighting spectrum than we do. So something that's visible to them down in the ultraviolet will be invisible to us. So the jury's still really out on this product, so I'm going to be super curious to see how well it works as it's being installed in more and more places. Etched glass is similar to fritted glass, but a lot of times beautiful patterns are built in. This was not built for bird safety, but would be extremely effective for helping birds to not fly through that clear barrier. This is an example of two kinds of etched glass that are being marketed by a glass company specifically to meet the standards that we know birds need to see that there's an obstacle there. It's at a nature center in Canada. This is an example of a physical barrier. This is screens. It's a public art demonstration, but it was used specifically to keep birds from, or it was incorporated in the plan specifically to help birds keep from hitting this glass access to public transit, and that's in Minneapolis. And then when you've built something and you end up having problems, your choices are a lot more limited. So that's why we really press people to think about it in the design phase. A lot of times you're limited to a physical barrier like that kind of screening or a surface treatment. And these are films that are were created. This is the company Aveda, a little sideline. If you don't already use Aveda products, consider it because they are such an environmentally responsible. It is not just show. They went to their expense to design a film for their problem windows at their corporate complex in Minnesota. And they even had to go to the length of finding films that had no vinyl in them because they had real specific rules about their whole, any products that they use. They have two different films they've created now. This was an experience at the University of Minnesota where they put in clear handrails, or handrails? What are those called? Not handrails, you know, the clear panels there. And within days of this brand new area opening, they were having birds a dozen an hour. Now that is really unusual, was how the birds were using it, but the way it was just like putting glass just in the worst place. So if there's one thing I could outlaw, it would be clear glass or mirrored glass anywhere just out in the world. Do you know what I mean? Like if there's one thing we just can't do is clear railings, clear glass in art exhibits and things like that out in nature. This is another commercial film that's available. It looks really beautiful and installed, very intentional. It's made in New York City. A couple other examples of films, dotted, striped. But basically, you see what you're trying to do here is you're trying to show birds that this is not a place to fly through, while at the same time giving people the clarity that they want. So it's this balance. In terms of operations, run your buildings in your community on lights out, like I mentioned. And in designing buildings, we're looking for this hot spot here. The pointer's not working, so you're looking for the useful light, directing light downward, not spilling light horizontally or vertically. Get rid of these. We got a lot of those in Minnesota. I think you probably do too. This is an example in Arizona where a really bad lighting design at a park was actually retrofitted. Arizona's really attentive to light pollution, and there's a lot of resources available from places like the International Dark Skies Association to help us tackle some of these problems. So in closing, I'll say what I always say to every reporter who asks me, do you have one other, what do you say in closing? If this is a real problem, and it's a preventable problem, that's the great news. There's so much being done, it's unbelievable how far we've come in just the 10 years that I've been working on it. So I would take it home for you, and what I always recommend people do, because you got a lot of bird advocates who are really like charged up about this issue, especially in my, at home for me now because of the stadium. And the first thing I ask them is, well, what have you done at your own house to fix this problem? So it doesn't have to happen. People tell me all the time, oh, birds hit my window. I'm like, your windows are fixable. So first, take care of it at home. If you're in a position to design or approve new designs, design it in and get credit for it. Tell people what you're doing and make a big deal of it because people get it. And if you have existing problems, find a way to fix them. Assess what you've got, plan your fixes, and implement. So thank you very much, and I am around all day to talk more.